Please join me in prayer. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The grace, mercy, and peace be yours this day from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The text for this morning's meditation comes to us from our gospel lesson in John chapter 12, read just a few moments ago. Today really marks the beginning of a great journey. A journey that begins with a parade, but won't end until there is a parade going towards an empty tomb to find that Jesus is alive. Some might say today marks the beginning of a celebration of really eight of the greatest days in all of history. And I think for all of us here today, we would look at that from that perspective. This is a day where our King comes into Jerusalem to suffer and die and be raised for us. This is a week that is completely incredible. It's a week that we are looking forward to. It is a week filled with joy and sorrow and contemplation and confession, forgiveness, and life. A lot of people will look at this week in different ways. Some will look at it as we would, filled with praise. Others would look at it as being somewhat meaningless. In fact, it is C.S. Lewis who said these words about the crucifixion of Jesus. He said that Jesus is not someone that you can give some credence to. He is either the Son of God who rose from the dead, or he's a nobody. He is either the Savior, or he's nothing. He can't simply be a good moral teacher, because Jesus himself said he is the way and the truth and the life. So if you don't believe him to be the way and the truth and the life, then you can't call him a good moral teacher, you call him a liar. So what do you say about Jesus? Who is he? He is either the Savior, or he's nothing. You really can't be in between. And as you look at the Palm Sunday text, that's actually what you're going to find. You're going to see a lot of different reactions, people looking at Jesus in a lot of different ways. But be sure, no one's lukewarm. Either they are calling upon Jesus, or they're looking for a way to arrest him and kill him. But regardless, if you were to look through this text for maybe the first time, you get to this point on Palm Sunday, and you start to see that something isn't going right. I mean, yes, things are going well, but too well. Things are just too good. They're going too smoothly, so to speak. If Shakespeare was writing this, he'd probably say there's something rotten in the state of Denmark. If Stan Lee were writing this, he'd say my spidey senses are tingling. If Jacob May were writing this, he'd say something ain't right. Now that's probably not going to catch on like the others would, but something ain't right. Something's going to happen. Because really what you have is a collage of different understandings, different beliefs, different ideas of what Jesus is going to do and what he's supposed to do, and they're going to collide right after Palm Sunday. It's kind of amazing how this all starts, this parade. I mean, Jesus doesn't organize it. He doesn't call up Masons to produce this and to get this parade going. It just sort of evolves. Jesus is at Bethany, which is really just a stone throw away from Jerusalem. Bethany's on top of a hill. You come down a big hill, then you go up, and there's Jerusalem. There are the gates. But see, people are coming out because they've heard about it. They've heard what Jesus has done. And it's not like they have to go very far. I mean, it's a great story. It's not like it's a typical miracle, if there is such a thing. But it's the story of Jesus going to Mary and Martha when their brother died, and they're calling out to Jesus, "Jesus, if you wouldn't have been here, our brother wouldn't have died." Not thinking that Jesus could do anything about that. But Jesus says, "Take me to him." And they do. There they are in front of a cold grave. And Jesus says, "Roll away the stone." "No, Jesus, please don't. He's already speaking. He's been dead for many days. Roll away the stone and Lazarus come out." And wouldn't you know it, there he is looking like a zombie. He comes out with burial cloths on, but he's not dead. He's alive for all to see. This isn't the kind of miracle you can explain away or keep quiet. Everyone is talking to everybody about what they have just witnessed. Someone who is dead is now alive. He gets all the way to Jerusalem, and everyone is coming out to see Jesus and Lazarus. You can almost picture them talking to one another. "Look, there he is, that guy. He was dead last week, and he's here now." Can't help but cry out. Something amazing is happening. "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." But not everybody has that perspective. Because then you have the Pharisees. The Pharisees who come out because they're hearing what's going on, and they're a little bit worried or concerned here. I mean, after all, if this is someone who's coming in and people are calling him king, what are the Romans going to do, the ones who are actually occupying Israel? They might squash this thing before it even begins. Not only Jesus, but anybody else who's supporting him. For the good of Israel, it might be best if they find a way to take care of Jesus. If they find a way to kill him. Let alone their own interests. Jesus isn't observing the Sabbath the way that they like. He isn't doing things and following the customs the way that they are used to following them. So you have these two sets of ideas and understanding, and then you have a third set. You have those disciples who have so much at stake. They've been following Jesus all along. They've left their nets to follow him, and they even ask the question, "What's at stake for us? Who gets to sit by you when you come into your kingdom?" And in Luke's gospel, they're the ones who are kind of stirring up the crowd. "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." This is what we've been waiting for. Jesus coming into his kingdom. This is something that's about to explode. Who is Jesus? You see, people want Jesus to be a lot of different things. What about you? Who do you see? Who do you say Jesus is? And what do you want him to be? See, it's a fair question. While we're here and now and after our sermon, we'll say the creed. We'll proclaim Jesus, right? The Son of the Father. In your lives, in your living, what are you proclaiming him to be? We've been going through Job on Wednesday evenings. We've learned a lot about suffering. We've learned a lot about tragedy. You know, there's some that when they go through those particular circumstances, suffering and tragedy, it's enough for them. You know, I just can't worship Jesus because I don't believe God would allow for us to go through all these particular things. So I give up. That's not the kind of Jesus I want to worship. Do you have others? The rules, the customs, the calling. That's just not for me. In fact, I heard that this past week about an individual, an actor. I love to be famous, I'm not going to smear his name. He says, I used to be a Christian. But the problem is, with Christ, I found myself not agreeing with him a lot of the time. I didn't want to serve. I didn't want to give. I wanted to be served. I wanted people to give things to me. I wanted everything to be about me. And this individual was able to find a religion that did that. Can you imagine that? God was seated there, oh, you don't agree with me. Well, I'll tell you what. I'll change all of the order of creation that was good and perfect so it fits Earth the way you want it to. But don't we kind of act that way? When we think about our sinfulness, the way that we choose what's wrong, even though we know what's right, it's basically like we're telling God, this way is actually better than the way that you created it to be. And the list could go on and on about a particular rule, a particular law, a particular commandment that just doesn't seem to fit our understanding, our philosophy of things. We don't need a Lord and a Savior. We just need to come here on Sunday and appease God by our presence, and then we can go and do whatever we want to do. We want God to do for us whatever we want Him to do. Isn't that the way we approach this whole thing? Is that Jesus, please, just be the Jesus we want. But we praise God today. We praise God for this parade and where it's going to lead to. Because I praise God and thank Him. That in Jesus, He doesn't give me what I want. In Jesus, He's not going to give the Pharisees what they want. And I thank God He doesn't give the people, the crowd, what they want. And He doesn't give the disciples what they want. And again, I'm going to say it. He's not the Jesus that I in my sinfulness would want Him to be. No, He loves us too much for that. Instead, He is the Jesus that we need Him to be. Where He is going to parade into Jerusalem. Not to be a buddy or a colleague to the Pharisees or a genie who grants wishes. But He is going to go to the cross to suffer and die for you. You see, that's the beauty of all of this. Like a good parent who knows his children, he's not going to give his children everything that they ask for. They'll be spoiled children. Children, did you hear all that? Spoiled children if you got everything you asked for. But like a loving father gives you exactly what you need. No. You might not get healed right then and there or every time you pray, but Jesus has come to give you the promise of a life where your body will be restored. No, I can't promise that you're not going to have those burdens, those times of suffering, but you have hope in the suffering and a day that is coming without it. Now, I can't tell you that you're going to get everything you asked for. You probably didn't win the lottery last night, did you? But He will provide for you. He will take care of you. And He forgives you. You see, that's the beauty of all of this. Is I hope for you that as you're heading into this week that is the greatest week all of our church year and all the years combined. Jesus could have run away on Monday Thursday with the desires. He could have run for His life. But He chose to stay. Because it's given and shed for you. He could have found a way to drop that cross. He's the Son of God. He didn't. He chose to die for you. So that Easter Sunday would come where He would defeat death for you. Indeed, I praise God and thank God that He doesn't give me everything I ask for, and He's not the Jesus I want Him to be. He's the Jesus that I need. The Jesus you need. Given and shed for us. Amen.
Amen.
And the peace of God which surpasses all understanding, keep our hearts and minds and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
This time.